This is Duke University.
Welcome to our fifth annual Feminist Theory Workshop. Last year, a certain amount of anxiety characterized some of the discussions in the corridors of Feminist Theory Workshop. I heard mutterings concerning some kind of demand to rethink the commonplaces of feminist politics and academic practices that sometimes go unquestioned. In relation to Catherine Mills's talk, participants worried about the concern with reproductive technologies, as if any attention to reproduction, especially by a visibly pregnant speaker, was bound by the most obtuse reproductive ideology, spurring affective responses that caused a couple of them, some of the more sophisticated participants, in fact, to say, "I couldn't relate to any of that because I've never experienced pregnancy or the desire for it." Hadn't we questioned all the relationship between theorizing and its relation to the experiential, I thought, but had she ever experienced detention in a war zone or torture and interrogation, such as that discussed by Coco Fusco? I don't mean this as a criticism of her or anyone else who had those feelings, so much as a call to think about the necessity of marking a not untypical reaction to what was ultimately a discussion about how theories of technology and embodiment abound between Heideggerian feminism on the one hand and medical technology on the other. I was struck by the continuing suspiciousness with which the pregnant body is treated or responded to, even as no experiential discourse is being necessarily invoked. Her embodiment then became part of the performance. Now, Coco Fusco, in a sense, dramatized such problems of the relation of the experiential to knowledge, as her work arose anxiety precisely because it was not seen as a performance. People wanted her to perform. Questioned the function of showing the participation in what is essentially a game of training for muteness in the face of detention and interrogation in a war zone. Participants wondered whether Fusco was then analyzing the strategies of training or whether she was presenting us with a discomforting performance piece, which was one that questioned the nature of violence. In discussion of Ray Chow's session, the question of violence came up again, with some anxiety about a challenging question Ray brought up concerning violence when she suggested that surely we would have to acknowledge that we cannot all agree what constitutes violence and identify it as such with certainty. Again, anxiety produced by some of those fundamental questions in the history of feminist thought, the knowability of violence. And Robin Wiegman, in a sense, partially addressed some of this anxiety around certainty in her work on what she called the problem of critique, particularly as experienced in the classroom, in which we have become so used to finding fault in works that we fail to acknowledge what was interesting, attempted, or strived for within them. The attack mode of some feminist thought, which she identified with critique, needed to be rethought. And that created anxiety concerning the meaning of the term critique and what it meant philosophically and pedagogically. Anxiety is perhaps the effective response that is initiated by feminist theorizing, which still embraces the speculative mode of analysis, but does not rest on its laurels and question its commonplaces. I'm confident that we will all feel challenged and impassioned once again by the talks coming up and the seminar in which you will participate over the next 2 days. Once again, the Feminist Theory Workshop is themeless this year, but I do think there are some questions that tie some of the speakers together, and I think also give us a way of attending to the questions of anxiety from last year. I admit this may be more about me than it is about any commonality among them, but let me sort of throw this out anyway. I'm currently teaching a course on a term that came up a great deal last year at the workshop, and it's a term that causes me all sorts of anxiety, as some people in this audience know, affect. And while we are working through much of the feminist work, referring back to Spinoza, Deleuze, Tomkins, Sedgwick, etc., with probably insufficient attention to the theorists of affect in feminist context, the theorists of care, wages for housework, Dorothy Thomas, Arlie Hochschild, etc., I've been interested in the currently non-dominant use of that term in Deleuzian-inspired work, that is in psychoanalysis and in the writing of Jacques Derrida. Some consider anxiety in psychoanalysis to be the affect, even in Freud. Affect is in some ways a technology that carries within it the spectral presence of another form of knowing and another way of being, one that may be otherwise than being. It is a form of being that is out of sync with itself, that does not belong to the saturated space of the centered ego, who dwells as being or a new version of that. It is an interface that would appear as a sensory disjuncture from a centralized ego or the centered subject of what Freud called civilization, with the normal level of unhappiness that comes with its demands, and what I would call modernity, with its material and conceptual histories. I would understand the psychical state of obligation between soma and psyche to be affect as a technology of touch, or following Lucy Rigoret's critique of Levinas, a technology of caress. All somatic and psychical manifestations, including senses, then, are understood as something felt, an auto-affection of for sorts, to use Derrida's term, later taken up by Patricia Clough, of course, an implicit questioning of self-sameness. This may be, in Irigaray's terms, akin to the caress of a lover that opens one-to-one, perhaps, through the mucous membrane, sensations external and external, eschewing sameness. Or it could be, in Irigaray's terms again, the sensation of pregnancy that is more than one, which is banalized in the technology of the ultrasound as reference to a face. Less literal than that, less distinct, less representational, less indexical, and less self-asserting, it is a sensation without identifiable content. In a sense, the struggle to know what affect is beyond particular affect speaks to the questions of the spectral form of a presence of alterity, of non-self-sameness. In 1926, and I'm not going to go into too much detail about this, but let me just give you this quote anyway. Freud writes of the manifestation of anxiety in instructive terms thus. Anxiety, then, is in the first place something that is felt. We call it an affective state, although, he adds, I think importantly and very reassuringly, we are also ignorant of what an affect is. As a feeling of anxiety has a very marked character, it has a very marked character of unpleasure, but that is not the whole of its quality. Not every unpleasure can be called anxiety, for there are other feelings, such as tension, pain, or mourning, which have the character of unpleasure. And thus, anxiety must have other distinctive features besides this quality of unpleasure. Can we succeed in understanding the difference between these various unpleasurable affects? So anxiety is felt. There's a sensory aspect to it that I would understand as the body touching itself, an auto-affection, even as it is an unpleasure. Through anxiety, Freud describes affect, even as he says he does not know what it is. It's unpleasurable because it's a loss of footing, peripatetic rather than dwelling or rooted. Can we understand and succeed in understanding its content, he asks? Yes and no. As an emotion with content and knowable origin held within a stable subject, yes, we can surely understand the histories of some emotions, have an engagement with the empirical without banalizing it. As a feeling that threatens unpleasurably, no, because the form of unbelonging that threatens indexicality is a loss of representation that is in many ways a sensory undoing. Its relation to content is spectral, a threshold to an alterity that nonetheless touches an interface that is the loss of alterity. And I think all our speakers in some ways engage with this question of an auto-affection, this form of touch, if you will, that shows, as Rosalind Morris would put it, how things and people are haunted by a radical exteriority whose excess and difference seeks to contain. Jagos, in both her fiction and critical writing, shows us of the non-identicality of terms like orgasm or feminism or lesbian, terms that are always haunted by empirical and historical differences that are marked in writing as imprints or even paw prints, for some of our other speakers, of singularity within the writing machine. If Pangcea seeks to address and understand the relation between technai and the human, it is to understand the way in which the human and the inhuman, animal and machine, are always touched by each other, haunted, as it were, by the way in which each encloses the other and can be seen as an opening onto the other, such as Haraway has taught us also to think, a way of terraforming that reaches beyond the attachment to a violent worlding. That is an auto-affection that, far from being narcissistic, is about an opening to the other, the risk of it, the anxiety of production that goes along with it. And now on to practicalities. Let me begin by identifying to you our keynote speakers, roundtable participants, and seminar leaders, and thank them all for coming and thank them in advance for what's going to be wonderful, I'm sure. Anna Marie Jagos, can you wave your arms around? Thank you, or just one. Donna Haraway, over there. Rosalind Morris, and Pang Chea. For the closing round table, we have Carla Frichero, Jane Gallup, and Kari Weil. And for our seminar leaders, we have all of the above, in addition to Diane Nelson, over there, Madeline Detloff, Kathy Rudy, Kimberly Lamb, Carlos Rojas, Robin Wiegman, and Ara Wilson. Thanks also to our moderators, Robin, Ray, Chow, Carlos, and Kathy. I also want to thank, of course, our tireless staff in Women's Studies. It's more than possible that they're not in the room. So please say thanks to them outside if you see them. They are Gwen Rogers, Marielena Weitzel, Melanie Mitchell, and of course, the one you all know from emails and from previous years, Lillian Spiller. Please do give them a round of applause. Many thanks also to our sponsors, including the following Duke University offices, programs, and departments: the Office of the Dean of Faculty, Asian and Middle Eastern Studies, Cultural Anthropology, the English Department, Evolutionary Anthropology, the program in the Study of Sexualities and Romance Studies. And I also want to thank enormously our institutional co-sponsors. As you may recall, the institutional co-sponsors commit funds to send faculty and students to us for the workshop. We do not ask them to commit any funds directly to us. So if you know that your institutions will commit funds, then you could make them into institutional co-sponsors. And we have more than we've ever had before this year, actually. The program in Women, Gender, and Sexuality Studies at Harvard, Gender, Women's, and Sexuality Studies at the University of Iowa, Women's, Gender, and Sexuality Studies program at Miami University of Ohio, Rutgers University Department of Women's and Gender Studies, Women's Studies at the University of Michigan, Ann Arbor, the Alice Paul Center for Women, Gender, and Sexuality at the University of Pennsylvania, Women's and Gender Studies at Dartmouth College, the Gender Institute at the London School of Economics, Gender and Women's Studies at the University of California at Berkeley, the Department of Women's Studies at the Ohio State University, and Emory University's Department of Women's Studies. So thank you to those institutions. For the second time this year, we have been able to partially fund 10 young scholars from outside the US, and they have come to the workshop, sometimes more than one from each of these places, from the Netherlands, Portugal, Australia, the UK, Hungary, and India. And I want to thank the Mary Biddle Foundation for funds towards them, and also to the Women's Studies Endowments. And in general, I need to thank contributors to the Women's Studies Endowments more that allow us to put this annual conference on. And last year, we tried a slightly new structure for the workshop, and evaluations indicated that you liked it. So once again, we are holding one long seminar after all the talks rather than two short ones. Each seminar will be led by two people, which is why you heard so many seminar leaders. We asked you to sign up for a seminar so we could distribute numbers evenly across the seminars and have assigned leaders to it. And as always, there's an interesting mix of Duke faculty and visitors. All seminar leaders will have made a significant contribution to the development and sustaining of feminist theory. And most will have participated in the workshops at Duke previously also. You should have a number on the back of your name badge, and that will indicate where you will be going. One other thing, we're trying to be a little bit more environmentally responsible this year, and that means that the evaluation for the workshop will be sent to you and will be online, and we'd really appreciate it if you could complete that as soon as possible while everything's still fresh in your mind. They're very helpful for us. On Saturday, that's tomorrow, there's a boxed lunch, and we'd appreciate it if you would break down your boxes and put them in recycling. And at the end of the workshop, please recycle your name tags also. So next year, another person can embody your site.
Produced by Duke University, online at duke.edu.